Obesity. People hear the word on the news, read it in countless health articles, see it on charts in doctors' offices, but do they really know what it means? What causes it? Obesity is not a cosmetic classification. It is a chronic medical disease that can lead to diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, gallstones, and other chronic illnesses. It starts when one is either born with a disease or genetic disorder, or with a weight of 10 pounds or higher.
Disorders that children are born with that are known to cause obesity include but are not limited to
hypothyroidism, Cushing syndrome, or type 1 diabetes. People with these diseases either have a pancreas, pituitary gland, thyroid gland, or an adrenal gland that does not work properly.
This results in the improper production of hormones, specifically
insulin, leptin, and cortisol. Insulin regulates the amount of sugar in the blood. Leptin sends signals to the brain when a person's stomach is full. Cortisol, a stress hormone, tells the body it needs to eat highly caloric or sugary foods. Children born with any of these ailments struggle to maintain a healthy weight. Adults also are susceptible to develop a hormone deficiency or an excess in these hormones. Parents provide both the genes and the food for their child. A child's diet is strongly influenced by its parent as early as 4 months of its life. Parents buy the food, demonstrate how to eat it, and encourage their children how to do the same. When children get older, portion sizes naturally get bigger. However, the danger is doubling or tripling that portion, which the child might not notice. Parents also have direct control of whether they eat at home or at a fast food establishment. The food industry picks up on this trend and aims most of their advertisements towards children by using cartoons, videos, and endorsements from celebrities or any other characters they might be familiar with.
And for even more fun, you can get apple slices and a mini minion of your very own from the new movie Despicable Me 2, rated PG, in your McDonald's Happy Meal.
This is done so that children will only want to go to those fast food establishments so they can get the toy or product they were promised on TV.
Dinner. I went to Whole Foods today and got this recipe from an extremely thin man with a giant Adam's apple.
I hate that place. None of the cereals are advertised on TV.
The foods sold by these fast food establishments have a poorer quality and are saturated with fats, sugars, and salts. Sugar has the same effect on the brain as cocaine. Once one says yes to it, one can never say no or put the spoon down.
I work at Combination on my secret hideaway shelf. And I pull out some Fritos corn chips, Dr. Pepper, and an old moon pie. Then I sit back in glorious expectation of a genuine junk food high.
Food addiction is like any other. The chemical dopamine is produced from these sugars and fats, making the body feel warm and happy. Then it sharply goes away, leaving the body with a craving for more. Specifically, the dopamine produces such a high that it blocks leptin hormones, which tell the brain the stomach is full. Food addiction is directly responsible for excess food intake. In the medical field, this is called an energy imbalance. That energy is measured in units called calories, and these infamous calories, if not used in other organs, are stored in fat cells.
Former food addict turned fitness addict, Landon Stulen, tells a story.
And that you were a bodybuilder, is that correct?
That is correct.
Were you always a health nut?
I was not. It was quite the opposite.
Quite the opposite.
Yes.
So how would you describe yourself before you were a bodybuilder?
Fat.
And what could you say caused your overweight?
Caused my overweightness?
Overweightness.
I just kind of overate. I kind of had self-image kind of issues. And, you know, everybody says they ate their feelings. I ate everybody's feelings almost. But I loved food. Food is still great, but I just had no control over like my portioning and that kind of stuff.
Could you say that you were addicted to the food that you ate?
Yeah, I would say I was addicted.
And what changed for you to become so healthy?
Well, initially, I just got sick and tired of being sick and tired, because I really was. I was emotionally and physically drained. And
Like Landon, during his years of struggle, many people who cannot control their appetite suffer from depression or other medical issues that may develop later in their own lives.
Many times when a person feels depressed, that person will resort to eating to make that person feel better. However, if a person eats too much or relies on food to make them happy, that person will definitely gain weight. Weight gain also is one of the leading causes of depression. Alas, the cycle starts again. Depression, indulging with sugary, fatty, or salty foods, weight gain, and depression again. America is saturated with food junkies. Little do they know what they're doing to their bodies. The long-term effects of obesity on the body specifically include high blood pressure, also known as hypertension, high cholesterol, low cholesterol, or high levels of triglycerides, type 2 diabetes, coronary heart disease, stroke, gallbladder disease, osteoporosis, sleep apnea and other respiratory problems, multiple forms of cancer, including skin cancer, lung cancer, stomach, colon and rectum, kidney, and many others. Mental illnesses such as clinical depression, anxiety, and other mental disorders. Body pain and difficulty with physical functioning. A general low quality of life and a shorter lifespan.
However, not all is lost. People who are extremely overweight or obese can experience many different methods to lose weight.
Many local hospitals, like Sentara, have weight loss centers, which help guide you through a proper diet and physical training. Weight loss surgery, also known as bariatric surgery, can either limit the calories you eat by shortening the intestines or shrinking the stomach. There are also many ways to manage these genetic diseases and conditions like diabetes, Cushing syndrome, hypothyroidism, and other insulin problems, including gene therapy, replacing certain genes in DNA, or taking certain medications recommended by a doctor.
Here are some helpful tips from professionals on how to become a healthy individual.
So I really just started lifting and didn't really change my diet at all. I just decreased the portions. Utilize what's like high repetition weightlifting, just people that don't like doing cardio. It's like just shortening your set times and getting your heart rate high in the weight room. I hired a prep coach that basically told me like what to eat and basically what cardio to do and that kind of stuff. So that was beneficial, just hiring a coach. And then I dropped like 5 pounds in a week or something. It was something ridiculous. And I was just like, wow, okay, what if I actually put some effort into it? And I did, and it paid off tenfold.
So coach, what does it take to have a healthy body all around in terms of exercise and nutrition?
I think you got to be committed to exercise throughout your entire life. I'm 74 years old. My wife and I probably go to the gym 5 days a week for about an hour to an hour and 15 minutes. I think I don't avoid a lot of foods. I eat red meat, I eat all that other stuff, but I eat it in moderation. So it's balancing your diet. I think a big thing for us is watch the foods, don't overindulge in a lot of foods, and that kind of does it for me. I think if you start avoiding or becoming too much of an extreme one way or another, it gets hard to balance a diet. So I think you just got to moderation in all things, and that seems to work. It's worked for us, worked for me, worked for my wife. So.
Hey guys, my name is Casey Vines. I'm the strength conditioning coach at Walsingham Academy. Just some info on my background, some info seems a little more valid, is I have a bachelor's in exercise physiology, I'm an ACSM certified personal trainer, and an NSCA certified strength conditioning specialist.
So with all of that background and studying over many years, what advice could you give to someone who is overweight and wants to be at a healthy weight?
The best advice I could give is to just move. You want to be as least sedentary as possible, even if that means just getting up, walking about 30 minutes a day. Even if you break up those movements, it's a 10 minutes of walking at 3 separate parts during the day. The most important thing is to keep moving. You can't sit down. The older you get, the longer you are sedentary, the more detrimental the effects are to you. So, you want to move, and you want to watch what you eat. Because it's so easy for you to overconsume food, because everyone always says, that, oh, I'm not eating that much. Unless you actually sit down and figure out and get a definite number of how much you're eating, you really don't know. It could be overeating, it could be undereating, you don't. So, you want to move, be as least sedentary as possible, and two, watch what you eat. It's not as hard as people think. It's all about moderation.
America is fat. As the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention states, more than one-third of U.S. adults have obesity. And obesity now affects 1 in 6 children and adolescents in the United States. Bad eating habits alone do not cause obesity. Genetics, strategic advertising, addiction, and medical disorders including depression share the blame. Obesity kills approximately 300,000 people each year.
People must eradicate it before it eradicates them. The only way to do so, expose children to good eating habits and monitor health risks.
And so eat it, just eat it. Don't wanna argue, I don't wanna debate. Don't wanna hear about what kind of food you hate. You won't get no dessert till you clean off your plate. So eat it, don't you tell me you're full, just eat it. Get yourself an egg and beat it. Have some more chicken.